Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. I'm so happy to meet you again. Today, I will talk about my new version of the rapid ultrasound guided management of CHOK. My protocol, REMSH protocol for CHOK. It will be evidence-based with a lot of videos and picture, real videos and picture, real cases, and you will enjoy a lot this amazing protocol of CHOK. Before I start, I need to announce about this coming anesthesia and surgical intensive care department Alexandria University conference. It will be held from 24 to 26 of September at Hilton Alexandria Green Plaza. In this conference, we will give an advanced critical care ultrasound course. I announced about this course before, but I need to correct here the date. The day one will be held at 24 of September, and day two will be 25 of September. I will talk about this protocol for CHOK. We'll talk about transcranial Doppler. We'll talk about optic nerve sheath diameter, valvular heart disease, extended fast, left and right ventricular systolic function, what's the ultrasound approach for weaning, and the service function. It's really an advanced critical care ultrasound. And for anyone who has the basic principle of critical care ultrasound, he will enjoy and will benefit a lot from this course. It is the first time to be held in Egypt, advanced critical care ultrasound course. Will be with me, Professor Dr. Ashraf Tayar. He is a figure in this specialty, with Professor Dr. Walid Al-Habashi, and I am sure you will enjoy this course. Okay. Critical care ultrasound is an absolute indication in shocked patient. And this is by the documentation of the very big organization. See here, Survival Sepsis Campaign, International Guidelines at 2016. They recommend further hemodynamic assessments, such as assessing cardiac function to determine the type of shock if the clinical examination doesn't lead to a clear diagnosis. And they suggest a dynamic over static variable to be used to predict fluid responsiveness where available in shocked patient. So, now you need to know about cardiac output and cardiac function, and the best way will be echo. In the task force of European Society of Intensive Care Medicine here about circulatory shock, you see, they recommend further hemodynamic assessments, such as assessing cardiac function to determine the type of shock if clinical examination doesn't lead to clear diagnosis. And also, they suggest that when further hemodynamic assessment is needed, echocardiography is a preferred modality to initially evaluate the type of shock, as opposed to more invasive technology. What else? International Federation for Emergency Medicine, they talk about point of care ultrasound in hemodynamic assessment. And here, RUSH protocol in Journal of Emergency Trauma and Shock, they talk about the accuracy of early rapid ultrasound in shock examination performed by emergency physician for diagnosis of shock etiology in critical patient. Please look at the number in this RUSH protocol. Look at this amazing number. They are talk about the most interesting finding was the valuable rule of RUSH protocol to outline obstructive cause of shock sensitivity 100%, specificity 97%. The second highest agreement of this protocol was for diagnosis of patient with cardiogenic shock, 89%. Hypovolemic shock, 86% agreement, and 100% sensitivity. Distributive shock, they found low sensitivity of 75%. It's still high, 75%. We talk about very big number in diagnosing obstructing etiology of shock, in cardiogenic shock, in hypovolemic shock, in the distributive shock. There are a lot of protocol summary of the current major protocol of point of care ultrasound for undifferentiated shock and cardiac arrest. There are a lot of protocol you see here, a lot of protocol for use of ultrasound in shocked patient. But why rapid ultrasound guided management of shock REMSH protocol? It is my protocol, which I tried in thousands of cases. Why this protocol? Because, as you will see, this protocol is not talking about the value of advanced critical care ultrasound in diagnosing the type of shock, but he go further in the value of advanced critical care ultrasound in diagnosing the cause of shock. It's not only the type of shock, but also in the cause of shock in most of the cases. This is number one. Number two, it is a step-by-step approach and will go hand by hand in diagnosis and the management, and you will see very easy to approach in very rapid way and organized way. A step-by-step approach, not just looking for the pathology here and here. Third, this REMSH protocol is talking about the management of shock. How can you manage shock? How can you give the best amount of IV fluids in shock patient? How to use inhibitors? My objective in this protocol is value of ultrasound in diagnosing causes of shock, diagnosis the type of shock and the cause of shock, cause of the type of shock, and the value of ultrasound in treating shock. But this protocol will be really long, so I will give the first part now about value of ultrasound in diagnosing the cause of shock, and the second part I will talk about the value of ultrasound in treating the shock. Okay, so as I just said, now it is a step-by-step approach. It is an organized step-by-step approach. Now you are going to see a shocked patient anywhere in the hospital, medical department, surgical department, ER, in ICU. What is the first thing you need to know? I believe the first thing you need to know in case of shock is the volume status. Because knowing the volume status, you can divide the causes and the type of shock to 50%, even 50% and 50%. So, go to look for the inferior vena cava. In a shocked patient, if you see this type of inferior vena cava, which is narrow, totally collapsing, you will think about hypovolemic shock, distributive shock, anaphylactic shock. If you see this type of inferior vena cava, which is dilated, non-collapsing, you will think about cardiogenic and obstructive cause of shock. So, one sign, you will divide the cause of shock even 50% and 50%. You will say, some people with tricuspid regurg may have full inferior vena cava and it could be hypovolemic. We'll talk about this situation in case of management of shock. In case of management of shock. But at least, if you see this extreme type of inferior vena cava in shocked patient, you need to go directly to the cause of shock, as I said. And at the same time, as I told you, this protocol is hand-by-hand diagnosis and the management. So, if you see this type of inferior vena cava, you can start to give IV fluids while you are assessing the patient. So you will start the management in zero time, which is very important in shocked patient. If you see this type of inferior vena cava, you can start inhibitors while you are examining the patient. As I told you, it's not only the type of shock, but the cause of shock. If you see flat inferior vena cava, narrow, collapsing inferior vena cava, you think about hypovolemic shock, sepsis, and anaphylaxis. As regard hypovolemia, especially if in case of trauma, you need the second step to go to advanced fast. So you need to look for the blood in the abdomen and in the pleural space. Search for internal bleed in the abdominal chest. You can, the blood appear black in the abdomen. This is subhepatic collection, subhepatic blood. This is blood in Morrison pouch, hepatorenal. This is blood around the spleen. This is blood in the splenorenal. This is the pelvic blood. This is the pleural blood. So, first, in hypovolemic shock, especially in trauma, go to advanced fast. And don't forget two things. Number one, dissecting aortic aneurysm. So you need to look for abdominal aorta, and you see this hematoma and the bleeding aorta, and you can look for the hypovolemia due to the third space in case of ileus ISIS patient. You see here, there is a lot of fluids, to and through fluids in the intestines, which lead to loss of a lot of fluids and can lead to hypovolemic shock. Second, septic shock. In my protocol, you will see now an archive for a lot of causes of septic shock. Almost all causes you need to think about in case of septic shock. What is the most common cause of fever and septic shock in ICU? As the basic teaching, traditional teaching, talk about VAP, ventilator acquired pneumonia, or hospital acquired pneumonia, line infection, urinary tract infection, and abdominal infection. Okay, let us see how can very easy to diagnose by my protocol. You see, this is a consolidation, hepatization of the lung with this white cord, moving white cord, as air bronchogram, getting up and down. Okay, it's very easy if you see this to diagnose pneumonia in your patient, because the normal lung is not consolidated lung, it is an A line. You see, this normal line is an A line. If you see this A line become consolidated, that means consolidation, hepatization, that means your patient has pneumonia. Second, line infection. You see this internal jugular, we remove the central line because of infection. You see this sick wall and the moving mobile septic thrombi here. If you see these pictures, you will not forget again. You can get this picture very easy by high frequency probe, put on the culprit vein where central line is going, and you suspect central line infection. If you see this, you will not forget again. And this is an objective diagnosis of central line related sepsis. What else? Urinary tract. If you see this full bladder with dirty urine inside, and you go up to see this dilated calcium system, pelvic system, and ureter with turbid urine inside, that means your patient has bionephrosis. Very easy to get it. If you see this fibrin everywhere, in the abdomen, in the pleura, in ascites, if you see this fibrin, this cord moving, that means your patient has here in chest, in empyema, or if in the lung, if in the peritoneal fluids, has peritonitis. You see these amazing pictures. Here is the liver, here is the diaphragm, white cord, and you see here, below the diaphragm in the liver, there is liver abscess, and above in the pleural space here, there is fluids, and there is white cord here in the fluids, denoting inflammatory reactions, and you see the inferior cavus through the liver, collapsing and narrow because of sepsis. This is amazing picture. You can diagnose liver abscess as a cause of sepsis in this patient. Please don't forget to look for the gallbladder in a septic, in the septic patient in ICU, because you have very common diagnosis, which is non-calcular acute cholecystitis, which is fatal disease. You will see here, this is a gallbladder, and you will see here there is very cholecystic halo and the sick wall denoting inflammation in the gallbladder. This patient really is a sickler patient with very bad salmonella infection leading to acute cholecystitis. This salmonella was only sensitive to meropenem, and despite a very big dose of meropenem, the patient kept febrile and septic, and with follow-up the patient, we look at the spleen to find these black areas of splenic, small splenic abscess causing a septic shock in this patient. Here is very important to look for ischemic colitis as a cause of septic shock in elderly people in ICU. In this patient, you will look for two things. Number one, dilated bowel with ileus, with a lot of dilated bowel, with to and fro fluid inside the colon. And number two, you will look for the air in the wall of the colon, which appear as bright areas, bright echogenic areas, which in the wall of the colon denoting air in the wall of the colon denoting ischemic colitis with a lot of fluids and ileus. And in this patient with ischemic colitis, you need to look for air in the portal tract radical, portal venous radical, because this is a normal liver, it's gray color, and the blood appear black inside the vein, portal venules and the radicals. But if you see a white cord of gases inside the portal radical in the liver, this is an ominous sign, this is a grave sign, because that means there is air in the portal tract, and that means it is very bad the intestinal sepsis and the ischemic colitis. You see here, white cord in the portal tract, here is black blood in the portal tract. And finally, last but not least, please, 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 attention, please. In any surgical patient coming to you from the OR and he is septic and kept septic, please look at the site of surgery. I respect the surgeon a lot. I respect the surgeon a lot, but please check most of the wound by yourself, because this is the first possibility in most of the patient is which is who is septic. You see this patient with decortication because of increased intracranial pressure. This patient was septic and febrile, and when I did ultrasound over by high frequency probe over the scalp where decortication done, I found this collection, and I found this very sick meninges, very sick dura, and moving fibrin of the dura and sickness with dirty dura and the meningeal wall, dirty brula with moving particles denoting inflammation of the meninges and collection above and collection in the subcutaneous tissue, and this is the cause of fever in this patient. And when we did CT with contrast, there is an enhancement of the meninges, enhancement of the meninges here denoting inflammation, and there is collection here subcutaneous and enhancement of the meninges and the fluids behind here. And this was the cause of sepsis in the patient. So please check your postoperative area by high frequency probe. It's very easy to get this collection black in, and you'll see fibrin inside in case of sepsis. I respect the surgeon, but please do it, because you will find a lot. Okay. Unfortunately, anaphylaxis is not diagnosed by ultrasound, but we'll think about it, inshallah, later on. So, if the inferior vena cava is narrow, you will give fluids, you will order a fluids very rapidly, and at the same time, you will check for the causes of the hypovolemia and the distributive shock by looking at major organ inflammation in lung consolidation, in central line, you will see for phlebitis, in urinary tract, you will see for turbid urine, and you will see for pleura and peritoneal for fibrins, denoting fibrin influence, denoting inflammation, empyema and peritonitis, and you look for the gallbladder, you look for the liver and spleen for abscess, and please, at the end, you need to look for the post-operative area, the wound, the surgical wound. And you look for the causes of hemorrhage in as in extended fast. In the area, splenorenal, Morrison pouch, pelvic, and pleura, and the aorta. But if the inferior vena cava is full and non-collapsing, which is fat, and your patient shock, please start inupressor, because inupressor like noradrenaline is best and is good for all causes of cardiogenic and obstructive shock. If you found your patient shock and if your vena cava is full, start inupressors. Okay, this is the elephant inferior vena cava, very dilated and non-collapsing. Look for cardiogenic cause of shock. You need to look for muscle myopathy, muscle disease, myopathy, ischemia. And you need to look for the valve, for significant valvular disease, for significant acute valvular disease, and look for vegetation as a cause of valvular disease. This is the most important. And don't forget to look for stress myopathy, because it's very common in ICU. Okay? And you look for right side if there is right ventricular infarction. So, start by looking for the muscle disease, myopathy. This patient has a ejection fraction of 5 to 10% as a cause of cardiogenic shock. If you see this wall motion abnormality, this is short axis view with the septum akinetic, not moving at all, and only lateral part is moving. So if this patient is shocked, you think about myocardial infarction, acute coronary ischemia in this patient, acute coronary. And as I said to you, look for acute valvular lesion. This patient has a stress myopathy with acute mitral regurgitation here. This patient has dilated aorta with acute aortic regurgitation here. Look for acute valvular lesion. This patient has vegetation as a cause of acute mitral regurgitation and the dilated left atrium. And as you see, in acute valvular disease, you will not expect to see dilated left ventricle. You will see left ventricle is normal size. You will see end diastolic diameter of left ventricle normal, which is going with acute event. But chronic event will lead to dilatation of the left ventricle. As you see in this patient, ballooning of the left atrium, and left atrium is more in volume compared to the left ventricle. This is going with acute pathology, which is leading to shock. You see this? Don't, please. You see this apical ballooning with basal contraction in case of stress myopathy. This patient has status epilepticus, and this is type of patient, this is very unique for stress myopathy. And to diagnose it 100%, you need to follow up this patient cured completely with very good and normal ejection fraction after controlling of status. You see this patient, dying patient with inferior myocardial infarction and right side, akinetic right side, dilated severe tricuspid regurgitation due to right ventricular infarction in patient with shocked patient. So, this is as regard cardiogenic cause of shock. But what about obstructive cause of shock? Really, the obstructive cause of shock is pericardial tamponade, tension pneumothorax, and pulmonary embolism. I saw 100 of cases of acute pulmonary embolism, but I saw tens of cases of tamponade and tension pneumothorax. So the common is acute pulmonary embolism. This is a common scenario you will see as a cause of obstructive shock. So I will concentrate here on the diagnosis of acute pulmonary embolism. How to diagnose acute pulmonary embolism? First, you need to look for the balloon will go to the right side. Right side will be dilated compared to the left side. Right atrium dilated, right ventricle dilated and compressing the left side. Normally, right ventricle is equal point less than 0.6 of the left ventricle. But here, right ventricle is more than left ventricle. You see here, dilated right side with tachycardia because of obstructive shock and compressing the left side. With short axis view, you will see what's called the D-shaped left ventricle due to pressure overload, pressure of the right dilated right side on the septum during systole. So you will see D-shaped during systole, but during the systole, the septum is getting up and the left ventricle will be around again. So D-shaped during systole, systole denoting pressure overload. You will look for McConnell signs. Hyperactive apex with akinetic septum. This movement of the heart is due to respiratory effort of the patient because of tachypnea. But really, the free wall is akinetic, it's not moving. The only movement is the apex of the patient. And this is because the right ventricle, it shares the apex of the left ventricle. And in case of severe pulmonary embolism and obstructive shock, there will be a huge sympathetic stimulation and a huge inotropic and increased inotropism of the left ventricle, increased contraction of the left ventricle, which take the apex of the right ventricle and get it this hyperactive like these pictures. This is McConnell signs. This is unique for pulmonary embolism. 60-60 sign. This is very important for acute pulmonary embolism. In acute pulmonary embolism, the right ventricle is thin wall. So, with sudden obstruction of the pulmonary circulation and the pressure overload of the right ventricle will not tolerate this pressure and will dilate and will fail. When the right ventricle will fail, he cannot contract vigorously to generate tricuspid regurg, to generate pulmonary hypertension. So, you will never see pulmonary systolic pressure more than 60 millimeter mercury in acute pulmonary embolism. In this patient, dilated right side, failure of the right side, and the tricuspid valve maximum is 26 millimeter mercury in low pulmonary artery systolic pressure. So this is the first 60 of 60-60 sign, which is unique for pulmonary embolism. You will never find pulmonary systolic pressure more than 60 because this failed right ventricle will fail to generate pressure. But with chronic core pulmonal, the right ventricle will become hypertrophic and has vigorous contraction and can generate high pulmonary systolic pressure and you can reach to very big number, even more than 100 millimeter mercury. The another 60 of 66 signs is the pulmonary valve acceleration time. You will put pulsed wave Doppler in the pulmonary valve and you will see the flow of the pulmonary valve and you will see the upstroke of the pulmonary valve from the beginning here to the peak here. This upstroke time, it's easy to measure by the software in the machine, pulmonary valve acceleration time. This time in the acute pulmonary embolism is less than 60 milliseconds, which is the second 60 of 66 sign. Okay, so now to diagnose acute pulmonary embolism, you need to think about the dilated hypokinetic right ventricle. So, in acute pulmonary embolism, you will think about dilated ballooning weak right ventricle. It's very important because this will differentiate between acute pulmonary embolism and chronic core pulmonale. As you see here in this patient, dilated right side, thin wall right side, weak right side. How can we diagnose the malfunction and the weakness of the right ventricle by what's called TAPSE, tricuspid valve annulus, tricuspid valve annulus plane excursion? You will put the MMOD cursor here in the lateral wall of tricuspid valve annulus here, and you will measure the up and down movement of this tricuspid valve, because right ventricle is moving up and down. It's not only contracting and squeezing the right left side like left side. It's moving up and down. And you can measure this up and down movement by the MMOD. In this patient, it's less than 1.7, which is normal. That means this patient has weak, dilated, thin wall right ventricle. And because of weakness, cannot generate tricuspid valve regurg to increase the pulmonary systolic pressure, pulmonary artery systolic pressure. You see here, weak contracting, thin wall. In contrast to the chronic core pulmonale, where the wall will be thick and the tricuspid valve will be vigorous, and the pulmonary systolic artery pressure will be vigorous, and the function of the right ventricle, which is TAPSE, may be normal. This is very important clue and differentiating between the acute and the chronic patient with pulmonary embolism. Moreover, if you see fresh thrombus in the pulmonary artery or in the right atrium or right ventricle, that means it's an acute process. You see here, short axis view on the place of the major vessels. You see thrombus here in the right pulmonary artery. And you can see very easy here, thrombus moving in the right atrium in subcostal view. And this thrombus, you need to thrombolyze. And after thrombolysis, you see here, nothing appear in the right atrium after TBA, but you see the dilatation of the right ventricle, acute dilatation of the right ventricle due to disintegration of the embolus, obstructing the pulmonary artery vascular bed and lead to pressure overload of the right side, and with a slow flow phenomenon, as you see here, the saline giving to the patient bubble appear in the right ventricle because of the slow flow phenomena of the obstructive shock. So this diagram is amazing and appear in the European Society of Intensive Care Medicine new guidelines about the acute pulmonary embolism, and will summarize all the features of the acute pulmonary embolism, which is enlarged right side, more compressing left side, D-shaped left ventricle because of compression of the right side, distended inferior vena cava, and 66 sign, as we mentioned, the pulmonary systolic pressure is less than 60 millimeter mercury, and the pulmonary valve acceleration time is less than 60 milliseconds, and you can see thrombus as you just saw, and you can measure the TAPSE, and you can measure even the by tissue Doppler imaging of the tricuspid valve moving annulus here. It will be same like TAPSE and will be weak upward movement of the patient, of the ventricle. Please, if you suspect pulmonary embolism, you need to look for the DVT as an echogenic material inside the right femoral vein here, and with non-compressibility of the right femoral vein, denoting the presence of the embolus, thrombus. And if you make color, you will see blood flowing all around the thrombus, where there is no blood flowing and there is no compressibility. This is the compression test for DVT. Second, pericardial tamponade as a cause of obstructive shock. You see this subcostal view, you see here the pericardial effusion and there's clot inside the pericardium compressing the right side. So in pericardial tamponade, you need first to see fluids around the heart in the pericardial sac. How can you know that fluids is the pleural or pericardial fluids? You will look for the descending aorta here. Fluids anterior to the descending aorta is the pericardial. Fluids posterior to the ascending aorta is the pleural, okay? Number one, you need to see fluids in front of anterior to the ascending aorta around the heart to diagnose pericardial effusion. And after that, you need to look for the signs of tamponade. Is this fluids causing tamponade or not? By looking at three things. The first, this is a calcification of the pericardium. The first is the systolic collapse of the right atrium, okay? With the systole here, with the closure of the mitral valve, tricuspid valve here, you will see inward movement of the wall, free wall of the right atrium due to systolic collapse, increasing with inspiration also, okay? This is number one, systolic collapse of the right atrium. Number two, early diastolic collapse of the right ventricle. You see here pericardial effusion. It is not too much, but you see here there is sick pericardium. It is sick exudative pericardial effusion. And you see here early diastolic collapse of the right ventricle. How can you detect it very clearly? By MMOOT. You see here in MMOOT, here is the diastole of the septum. And you see here in early diastole, you will see collapse of the free wall of the right ventricle and compressing the right ventricle here. Early diastolic collapse of the right ventricle. This is the septum and this is the free wall of the right ventricle. And you need to see the hemodynamic consequence of this collapse of the right ventricle by looking for the tricuspid valve flow variability with breathing. You see here with inspiration, the tricuspid valve flow, you see here 78 centimeter second velocity, increased velocity, but with expiration is low velocity. This variation with respiration denoting hemodynamic instability due to pericardial effusion, and you see here it's more than 35%, the difference between inspiration and expiration, and it's going with tamponade. Okay. Now you know about cardiogenic causes of shock and obstructive cause of shock. Okay, think about this pathology by. If there is cardiogenic causes of shock, probably this patient will have pulmonary edema. So, if you look at lung ultrasound, you will see a lot of P-line and a lot of congestion. But if there is obstruction, like in pulmonary embolism, that means if obstruction like pulmonary embolism, that means there is obstruction of the blood going to the lung, so the lung will be oligemic. So please put the probe on the lung to look for lung water. If too much, it is cardiogenic. If too less, too low, it is obstructive. You see here, you will see this A line in obstructive shock like pulmonary embolism, and you will see this P line in cardiogenic shock due to a lot of cause of cardiac failure. Okay? And now you reach to the lung. Please, while the probe in the lung, put the high frequency probe to look for the third common cause of obstructive shock, which is the tension pneumothorax, to diagnose by high frequency probe. During assessment of lung water, Please check for sliding to diagnose the third important cause of obstructive shock, which is lung point, which is 100% specific for pneumothorax. You will see area of the pleura here sliding and intersect here with area not sliding. This is the end of the pneumothorax here. Here is normal, here is the pneumothorax. And if you put M-mood here, if you get a pneumothorax, you will see what's called barcode. And if you put it here, you will get seizure, which is the hallmark of the pneumothorax. You see here. Here is the seizure, which is denoting a moving air. Because normal lung, there is a moving air. Moving air will appear granular appearance with M-mood, and this is the subcutaneous tissue will appear static. So you will see seizure appearance. But if there is air in the pleural space, you will see static air. So you will not see a granular appearance of moving air, only static air. This is the barcode. And this is a very good review by Professor Mayo in the Intensive Care Medicine Journal. And he mentioned here the lung point is 100% specific, but only 60% sensitive for pneumothorax. Okay, here I finished the first part of protocol, REMS protocol for shock. And inshallah, recently I will upload the second part, which is the main, what is the main treatment of shock. And see you later. And I am so happy to meet you again. Bye-bye.